Welcome to Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and this evening I am delighted to be joined by Russell Boyce and Lawrence Connolly. Now, before we talk about a fantastic away win for Celtic in Europe this evening, we were very saddened earlier on today to hear that the manager of St Rocks, Paul Kelly, very sadly passed away peacefully this afternoon. And we want to pass on our regards and our respects to all of his friends and his family and everybody within the wider St Rocks community. He had been in the ACSOM studio. He helped us out with the charity weekend last December. And he very sadly passed away. So thoughts and prayers with everybody who knows Paul. And we hope that, you know, Stevie Mullen and everybody at The Rock will know that he's in our thoughts and prayers. And everybody that knows him will be very sad at his untimely passing as well. So say a wee prayer for Paul and his family tonight. But this is the day that we win away. Russell, everybody was calling for a bad day to come off at half-time. He proved them wrong, didn't he?
He was very, very impressive. That finish was outstanding. It was an acute angle. He took it with aplomb. I think it was the right thing to do to keep him on. Anyway, as I say, I felt he was playing with a wee bit more confidence in that first half than perhaps we'd seen in his last sort of dozen of games. And I thought, yeah, I thought it was the right thing to do. He had an assist already on the stats board, whatever you want to call it. And then he goes and gets a goal. A beautiful through ball by Kyogo, of course. But, it was brilliant. He brings a lot to the team when he's on form like that. And again, you might just see him ramp up a few notches now with the presence of James Forrest now being, you know, back in the first team picture as well. And like we've touched on before, it's just a wonderful option or a couple of options to have on that side of the park. And I would expect them fully to both go on and push each other this season, and both of their seasons actually end up pretty fruitful.
You know, it was interesting on the 68th minute to see the triple change, because it shows you that we do have options. There was a few people who looked at Yakimakis's performance against Livingston and were unimpressed. I think that he showed enough in the 20 minutes or so when he came on that he does have, Lawrence, a football brain. I mean, holding the ball up, winning, wee niggly challenges in winning free kicks, frustrating their back line to the point where that booking was probably an hour after it should have been, because I mean he got away with two or three in the first half. But Yakimakis showed his experience and he was very crafty, and sometimes in a game away from home in Europe, you've got to be.
Yeah, I mean, you saw the wee look over his shoulder, saw where the boy was, and just bought a free kick. And he'd done that a few times. You know, he bought a free kick and he's killing the game. Ange making the triple sub meant that we still have another two subs to make when we're going to, you know, Beaton picks up, whether it's an injury or a bit of cramp, gets some minutes in McCarthy. I mean, we called two out of the three subs, didn't we? We said, you know, wait to 60, 70 minutes and we'd take Abada and Kyogo off and bring Yakimakis and Forrest on. We didn't call Yota coming off, but, you know, protects three your informed players, keeps them safe, and gets minutes in the legs of guys that need it. I thought James McCarthy done really well when he came on.
He did.
Few decent blocks. That ball to Turnbull as well just changed the pace of it. You know, Turnbull wins a free kick. Yeah, it's great performance for us. You know, we lose a late goal, but really they were needing to draw level with us in head-to-head. They were going to need to beat us by two goals. By the time we lost that goal, they were never getting another three. You know, it's...
It was a consolation. I mean, at no point, I know that Joe Hart was very unhappy with his defence. I don't think Ralston closed them down quickly enough. I think Carter Vickers even was maybe guilty, you know, moving out with the road of the ball as well. And Hart was very unhappy with that, because he wants to have the two-goal cushion going into the last couple of minutes. But let's talk about the goal, Russell. I'm going to come to yourself. We had a corner kick. We played it short. And they lost the ball. David Turnbull loses the ball. He's 5 yards away from their touchline. He wins the ball back 5 yards away from the halfway line. Unbelievable, a bit of tenacity to win that ball back. And when he wins it back, he takes his time. He plays the correct pass. By the time it gets to Kyogo, when you look at the weight, the way that he's used his body weight to get in front even though he's in complete control of the ball, to get in front of the oncoming defender. And then that pass was just absolutely sublime. There was a wee bit of frustration. There was a wee bit of criticism about Abada at half-time. That's seven goals. That's a guy who's just turned 20-year-old and he's scoring important goals again in Europe. That was a fantastic goal from start to finish.
Absolutely. And I know you do your schedules very organised, Paul. Even during the half of football, I'm sure there will be a chapter called David Turnbull, because for me, that was the best he's played this season, particularly that second half. I thought he was outstanding. The goal summed up two sides to him. Two sides of him that, one that we became a wee bit of accustomed to, you know, the brilliant pass to Kyogo, but the tenacity to win that ball back, I hadn't really seen much of that before. And it was a proper 50-50 that he's won there, you know. And then again, like you say, once he's done that, it's not because the adrenaline's pumping and he can't keep his cool. He keeps his cool. Plays a brilliant pass to Kyogo. He sticks the butt out, turns his man, and the weight of the pass is, it's like it's not even on the grass. It's just like sort of floating above the grass. It's just perfect, isn't it? And Abad's still got a bit to do there, though, right enough, despite how good the pass is from that angle.
Controlled, absolutely controlled. Yeah. And we've not even mentioned Kyogo's hair. I mean, if we're going to be asking the fashionista, we're going to have to ask you, Russell, a wee change of direction on Kyogo's hairstyle. And to be fair, I think it suits him. But when you're looking...
That's from a peroxide.
Is that peroxide? Is that not natural? When you're looking at Turnbull, I remember when Ange Postecoglou came in and we tried our best to get an overview of his style, the type of players that were going to suit his style, Russell. And we spoke to Dan Horowitz, who is a journalist for the Japan Times. We spoke to Jared from Celtic Down Under. We tried to get an idea of the types of players who would be suiting Angie's style. And one of the worrying things was, it appeared that David Turnbull may not suit Ange Postecoglou. And the argument was that he likes his forward players to be good at winning the ball back. And we hadn't seen a great deal of that. For all the silkiness of David Turnbull, we hadn't seen a great deal of that. And we lamented the loss of El Yunusi and Christie, because they were particularly good at winning the ball back. And we've seen it tonight, not only with David Turnbull, we've seen it from Anthony Ralston. He goes up the park, loses the ball, but he wins it back at the halfway line. So he's drilling this into the players who previously weren't great at doing that.
Yeah, you put that to me. I agree. The tenacity of Turnbull's moment, and then again, you're right to highlight Ralston's one, because he does make an error. But that's going to happen. That happens in a game. I love the fact that Ralston now just takes full responsibility when he makes a mistake. You know, he's playing this season, particularly maybe the last half dozen of matches, above his years, right? In terms of, you know, there's moments that you're now going to, you're going to encapsulate all, you know, you put them all together, you look at the moments where he's starting on defenders who are picking on Kyogo. You know, he's pulling guys up off the ground.
Yeah.
He's thundering at tackles that matter. And then you get that tonight. He makes a mistake. Who's going to pick up, you know, my mess? I'll do it myself. I think that's really encouraging to see from Ralston. And again, like we were saying about this age group of players, I would guess David Turnbull's, 22? Maybe 23 now? Something around the same age as your Ralstons, for example. Think a bit of what Ralston's impact has rubbed off on David Turnbull when you see that 50-50 there. I mean, maybe just I'm getting overexcited about Ralston, but I've never seen Turnbull crash into a 50-50 shoulder-to-shoulder like that with such sort of channeled, albeit aggression. I thought it was brilliant to see that side to his game. That tenacity is something that I didn't really attribute to him, and nor have I particularly looked for it in David Turnbull, but to see it's brilliant. And if you can start getting guys doing that, and again, maybe not just the influence of Ralston, you look at wee Kyogo's tracking back from the start of the season. We've spoke about it numerous times. Not just his actual work rate, but the amount of tackles he makes, side tackles to put the ball out of play, you know, chasing back players, you know, whether it's been his mistake or not, right enough. And maybe they are. This is one of the messages from the manager that they're all beginning to pick up on slowly but surely. And I certainly hope, if it is one of Angie's messages, that it's work rate, you know, and everyone's got to dig deep. You know, if you've got to track back, everyone's got to be a runner. I'm all for it. And I thought we'd seen tonight all the good bits about what Andrew's trying to do. And again, Celtic proved tonight that they are a box of chocolates, because you never know what you're going to get. And that is what's happening again. You know, if you look at Hibs away last week, we were gushing over that first half hour. You look at Livingston, miserable Saturday afternoon, as dross as I've seen us all season. And then you look at tonight, particularly the first sort of, I thought, 25 minutes that second half, some of the intricate play we played was outstanding on a few separate occasions. And you begin to get that excited way again, thinking, is this where we're going? And it's just trying to sustain it a bit, which I appreciate will take time, but a lot to be positive about tonight.
No, what you're was your right. question? No, it was a good answer, regardless. When we looked at the lineup, Lawrence, all week, we've been talking about a couple of the dilemmas that perhaps Ange faced. Maybe they weren't dilemmas to him, maybe they were obvious choices. In the centre-half position, we lost Carl Starfelt. He's out for a couple of games. He'll miss the Dundee game as well. We bring in Stephen Welsh. Let's have a wee chat about Stephen Welsh's performance. He comes back in from the cold, Lawrence, and I thought he equipped himself very well tonight.
Yeah, I mean, I think we touched it at half-time. A couple of mistakes. One, you know, he slips, the other ball gets caught under his foot, but he remains calm and recovers both. He doesn't panic. He's done well in the air. He's done well with his passing. He just looks at an assured player, doesn't he? Beyond his years, he's definitely a guy we can rely on. He's had a great season so far, I would say. You know, when he's been in the team, he's not let himself down or Celtic down. So it's good that we've got someone like that can step in. And when you look across that defence, what's he, 22, 23?
So young defence. I mean, Carter Vickers is only 23.
22 yeah. for Ralston. And what's your Anovic, 25, 26? Really young defence, isn't it?
Mm.
You know, and it's a defence, you know, if they keep playing like that, they can definitely play for a number of years together. But I think, you know, Ange has shown us that he got his subs right. You know, he can make three different groupings of subs, shall we say. He's protected three good players. And then he's been able to give minutes to McCarthy, which we were also talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And Scales gets a wee bit of time when he takes Welsh off. I don't think we could get anything more for the game, could we? You know, another win, you know. Really good performance. Abada, I mean, that finish, I think early in the season, he's putting his laces through it. He side foots that in at the bottom corner. You know, he doesn't panic. He knows what he's doing. It's right in the bottom corner. It's great performance all round.
I thought it was a great performance all round. What was your thoughts on Stephen Welsh, Russell?
Yeah, I thought he had a good game. Just complete composure. Just to quickly touch on the subs, I think... just because I answer whatever question I want these days, Paul, it seems. I don't mean that in a bad way. I just get drifted on tangents. But the substitute thing, I think, is really important. I thought that was the right way around we did it tonight. It was the same way around we could have done it on Saturday. Get the job done and then sort of, you know, rest the legs of the likes of Kyogo, because what's a difference he makes? And again, I thought the subs Ange actually made tonight, the triple sub might have looked bold, but he was right on every count. Right on every count for various reasons. For the players going off and protecting their conditioning, fatigue or whatever, and to give minutes in the legs of the likes of Johnston, Giakoumakis, who Johnston's coming back from a long-term injury. Giakoumakis hasn't played a lot of football, as we know, since the end of the Dutch season last year. It was all at the right time. And I hope as well, you know, I think, you know, sometimes... it's easy to react really negatively to a defeat or particularly aim at the manager, perhaps, because he's been in charge for 18 games. Giakoumakis, I felt, got it a wee bit too tight for one poor game, you know, where I feel like he's actually been looking all right so far. And I thought tonight, again, the European stage seemed to suit him very well. Back to your question about Stephen Welsh, 100%, no qualms about it. You feel confident putting him in the team.
Yeah, you do. That again is a good point about Giakoumakis, though, because he did get a fair bit of criticism.
Yeah.
He didn't have a great game. He misses the penalty against Livingston. But I think back to the performance at Celtic Park against Ferencvaros, where he's come on and he's held the ball up so, so well. He's winning free kicks. And I think to the other option that we have, who wasn't even on the bench tonight, in Albion Ayeti, I never seen any of that from Albion Ayeti. So... Giakoumakis, I think, yeah, it's important that we get as many minutes in his legs as possible. And Livingston was just a bad day at the office. I mean, here's a player who, for me, I thought he showed a lot of good touches. He's got quick feet, you know, and I think that Juranovic, something that we didn't point out at halftime was the importance of his saving tackle just before the halftime whistle. He was quiet in the first half, Juranovic, playing in the, obviously, an unfamiliar left-hand side of the defence. But he won a very important tackle just before halftime, and it seemed to give him a wee boost in the second half. I thought he was excellent in the second half, very comfortable with the ball at his feet, uses the ball really well. And he's very, you know, the tempo goes up when he gets the ball, Russell. He's very comfortable at taking on a player and passing it very quickly. I think Lawrence made a very good point earlier on about McCarthy. Up the right-hand side, as good as it looked, Giakoumakis and James E. Forrest were playing the ball about. It came to McCarthy, and they completely changed the tempo of the game with that through ball. He'd done the same thing against Raith Rovers. I know it was a different standard of the opposition. And we ended up winning the corner kick, a free kick rather, because David Tumble wins the ball and he's fouled. What was your thoughts on James McCarthy? I know he wasn't on the park for a great length of time. He comes on in 77 minutes for Beaton, Lawrence. We had a good conversation and discussion about him at the beginning of the game. I don't think he put a foot wrong.
No, listen, he's a level above most of the players at the club just now, isn't he? You know, he's a proven EPL level player. He's an internationalist. As you say, he can change the pace of the game or the tempo of the game with just one pass. He won a few important headers. He was blocking runs. Yeah, he just slotted straight in, didn't he? And it's minutes in another player that needs minutes in his legs.
Yeah.
So, you know, we were talking about before the game, you know, when's it going to be the right time for him? Well, he's came on today. You know, I know it's only, what, 13 minutes plus four injuries, 17 minutes. But he's not put a foot wrong.
Even if he is to be the backup. And I mean, listen, it was a wee bit of tongue-in-cheek before the game. We were talking about Victor Wanyama because he's come out, and I don't know if he's been led into the conversation. He's come out and said that he wanted to sign for Celtic under Neil Lennon. It's the club he wants to return to. That is the position, that number six. And we seem to have an issue with that. So tonight we play Beaton. How do you think Beaton played, Russell?
Yeah, I think particularly second half, I was quite impressed with Beaton, to be honest. I actually feel he gets more confident as the game grows on. I don't know. I know it's a lot of safe passes that he plays, but I also think he lacks a wee bit inner belief at times, and that's the reason for the sideways balls. See, once we got the two-goal cushion, there was one moment, he's just inside the centre circle, and there's a wee sort of shimmy, and this beautiful, just like sort of 8-yard, 10-yard pass towards the left-hand side, and it was quick thinking, and it's forward, and it actually progresses the Celtic attack. He didn't do any of that on Saturday again. You know, and I wonder if once we get in front, you actually start seeing him loosening up, for the want of a better term. I think he loosens up and he shows a wee bit more of his ability that he obviously has. You know, this guy was at Man City on trial before we signed him, if you recall. In fact, ironically, played in Australia, I believe, on his trial match, because I remember watching the highlights before he signed. But I think Beaton maybe allows Callum McGregor to, I don't know, express himself a bit more. I certainly wonder if David Turnbull took the game by the scruff like we were alluding to before the game because Tom Rogic wasn't there and he felt he had to, or because he's got that safety net of Beaton behind him. And again, like McGregor, he feels more comfortable taking more risks. Again, though, to counter that, why it didn't happen on Saturday, I'm not entirely sure. But based on Beaton's performance tonight, can't take anything away from it. Although I agree with Lawrence, I think when McCarthy came on again, he did absolutely nothing wrong. He leaves another question mark over as to, is it a fitness thing? Will someone just come out and say that? Because it might make us all feel a bit better about it, that we're building him up to match fitness. Because if it is a straight shootout between two 100% fit players, I think most people would like to see McCarthy ahead of Beaton. Nothing to take away, though, from Beaton's performance tonight.
Absolutely. Let's get some of the comments coming in. We're kicking around at the 1400 live. So thank you all for tuning in. We are going out live on Facebook, on LinkedIn, YouTube, Twitch, and Twitter. Mark McMonagall, Abada must have been listening to the podcast during halftime. Come on, you boys in green. I think the three of us were saying, you know, don't take him off just yet. There will be an occasion during the game and an opportunity to bring on Forrest, but, you know, Ange was proven right. Abada got his chance, and by God, he did take it. David Kelly comes in, long-time viewer. Welcome to the show, David. Been a critic of his, but Turnbull has had one of his best games for us tonight. Looks like he is maturing as a player. I wouldn't say you've been a critic. Yeah, but Lawrence, you have picked up on a few performances by Turnbull over the last few months. But tonight was one of his better games, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely one of his better games. You know, that tenacity he showed. I suppose it gets back to what Ange said. You know, we never stop. It's a feeling a lot of footballers have, whether they, you know, play a good pass and they stand and watch it, or that they make a mistake and they stop for a minute. You know, I think the players are starting to get it. You know, we never stop. You make a mistake, you don't stop. You go, you get the ball back, you do everything you can. Listen, when he delays that pass to McGregor just to let McGregor get a wee bit further forward, and McGregor, you know, it makes it easy for him, doesn't it? Definitely one of his better games from Turnbull, and we do forget probably he's only 22. But listen, maybe they do feel better with Beaton behind them, and we've got to remember Beaton's getting used to playing as a defensive midfielder again. He's played for so long as a centre half for us, so maybe he's grown in confidence that the more he's playing in that position for us.
Yeah, you know, the thing with Beaton, we were looking at his career last week, and the fact that, you know, next season he will be celebrating 9 years at the club. And when you look at the transition at Celtic we're going through, we had the discussion during the pre-season around Scott Brown and whether we should have kept him for the transition, Russell. But, you know, when you look at his experience at Celtic, the honours that he won as the captain, there was a concern that we were losing too many heads of departments, and, you know, Peter Lowell leaving the club, Neil Lennon leaving the club, Scott Brown, we didn't know we were going to lose two CEOs. But you should be able to look at a player like Nero Beaton and say, well, he's been at the club for 9 years. He's the guy you should be able to hang your hat on. He's the guy that should be able to come in on the big games and settle down a lot of these younger players. We're talking about how young a lot of the core of the team is. Well, let's look to Nero Beaton as well as your James Forrest and Callum McGregor. I think Beaton needs to step up to the mark and perform like he did tonight. He needs to add a bit of composure to his performances, and I think we saw that this evening.
Well, it's a marked improvement from his European outing against Midtjylland, where it was a petulant action that really did cost Celtic that night. You know, what might have been, you know, because we were in cruise control in that game, and hopefully that is the last time we see him doing one of those silly actions, because I think you're right. The benefits of Beaton can certainly be seen, and if he can actually just put a mature head on his shoulders, you know, for the amount of experience that he's got, use it. You know, use that experience. And I thought tonight, for the best part, I thought he did. I think, you know, the Pretoria game obviously stands out as one of his better games, and perhaps you'll see a bit of a comeback for Beaton. For me, he's had a lot of bites at the apple, though, you know. I think, or whatever the saying is, I'm terrible at that. But I think, you know, he's had a lot. A
couple of bites at this cherry, is it not?
That might be it. But a couple of Beatons at it. But I think he's just, over 9 years, he's had enough time now to have cemented that jersey and to be that influence like you're talking about, like James Forrest, Cal McGregor's. And I just think, like, tonight, yes, it was brilliant. And I want to be positive about the team's performance first and foremost, by the way. So I thought it was excellent, Beaton included. Would I be looking at him as a guy to hang my hat on? I just don't know. I just don't think he'll ever get that fair crack of the whip for the fans again anyway. To be honest, I think there's too much. You know, 9 years is a long time not to be a regular, you know, and someone who's still trying to poke people in the eye.
Yeah, you ask yourself, at what point was he ever, the first pick? Very few and far between has that been the case. I was talking earlier on today to Tony Haggerty about one of the best times of my Celtic supporting life, and that was during the time of Tommy Burns, where we only won one trophy. And we were talking about when he came to the club. At that time, Charlie Nicholas and Pat Bonner had both been given free transfers. Not only did Tommy know them as a player and as a teammate, he also realised that the experience that they had and the knowledge they had at Celtic was going to be very important to him during the transitional period where we're playing away from Celtic Park. Yes. You need that, you know, the experienced heads. And they didn't play much, but they were there, and that was important. And I think that when I look at the likes of Niamh Beaton and Tom Rodgick, they've always kind of been bit part players. And it's about time they stepped up to the plate and showed that kind of experience that you should have being at a club like Celtic for 9 years. We've brought in some experience in Joe Hart and James McCarthy, and we have players that are the obvious leaders in James Forrest and Callum McGregor. But I just think, you know, tonight's performance by Beaton is the type of performance we should be expecting from someone with that experience, Lawrence.
Well, yeah, listen, he's a 30-year-old professional footballer. He should be in his prime, shouldn't he? He certainly looks a lot more comfortable in centre midfield than he, or defensive midfield than he does at centre half. And I think that's, he's going to have a future with us. That's what it's going to be. Mm. I'd rather see him there than Sorrow. And I think it is going to be, I'd rather see him there than McGregor, because it lets us put McGregor further forward.
It frees him, yeah.
So I think it is going to be a straight shootout between him and McCarthy for, you know, to hold that jersey down. Beaton's, you know, he gives us a bit of extra height. And as we saw when we had to make subs against Libby when Starfield went off, you've always got the option when a team's not attacking you too much, can drop back and be the second centre-half. But listen, hopefully he can build on that and go on and nail the place down, because, you know, he's an experienced international player.
Mm-hmm.
His ball retention's great. He maybe doesn't try, as Russell kind of touched on earlier, doesn't try too many risky passes. Maybe that's down to his time playing at centre-half. He's kind of iron those out his game, or when he's tried them at centre half, he's been punished. So hopefully he gets a wee bit more confidence with those behind him and playing a position. He starts to make the game changing passes, because he can do it. And we were talking about during the second half, he's a guy that used to have a decent long range shot that doesn't seem to hit them anymore.
He doesn't seem to hit them at all. I mean, I was going to make the point, I thought that Callum McGregor was well prepared for two or three occasions he's hit a long range effort. We spoke about it before the game. Sometimes it's difficult to break down a side, so go for the long range effort. I don't just mean speculative pings from anywhere, you know, the shoot on sight policy. And I think it fared us pretty well tonight. I know that we're playing different opposition, but we played completely differently tonight. There wasn't 20 crosses per half. You know, we played far more directly down the centre, and it worked a treat, because that intricate pass between, you know, Turnbull winning the ball, passing it to McGregor, onto Kyogo, onto Abada, what a well-crafted goal that is. That's what we can do, and it all went through the centre, Russell, rather than try to play it wide, try to get the ball in. Kyogo can't really get on the end of it. Even Giakoumakis doesn't seem to have got on the end of much when we started them against Livingston. I'm going to bring this up because I feel after a result like tonight that it's a good result. It's away from home. It's a European game. Now, Ferencvaros, absolutely. I mean, their victory against Celtic last season, and I was talking to Willie McStay yesterday, who keeps an eye on Hungarian football because he was a manager at Ujpest Dosha. He keeps an eye, he's got a very good knowledge of Hungarian football. He was talking about the impact of that victory to Hungarian football, the money coming in from, you know, Ferencvaros actually beating Celtic last season and getting into the group stages of European football was massive. But it creates another kind of like a gap between the likes of Ferencvaros and the chasing pack. So I'm looking at that and I'm thinking, well, they should be stronger than they were last season, because obviously they've had the further investment, but they did lose their manager, who was a massive part of their success. But I'm happy when we win a game like tonight away from home. Some Celtic fans are still looking at where we are when it comes to European football. So I'm going to bring up this point by Terence Pat, who comes in on a regular basis and you're watching on YouTube. Welcome to the show. It's not negativity, it's realism. Some Celtic supporters are happy with Celtic going into the third tier of European football. I'm not. Standards have dropped. Now, when I was growing up, there were always three competitions in Europe, European football. Because you had the Cup Winners' Cup, the European Cup and the UEFA Cup, and they've been rebranded and changed and dropped, etc. But obviously, we've created a third tournament. And in the 4.5 years that we've been running ACSOM, Lawrence, I'll come to you first, we've gone from what I thought was a Champions League club, and I don't mean Champions League in terms of winning the competition, but under Brendan Rodgers with that side, I felt that we should be qualifying for the group stages season on season. That would have been my ambition. But as time's gone on and we win against Lazio, and you're happy to win against Lazio, you then start thinking, well, maybe we are a Europa League club. But then this argument has come in, and Russell, you've discussed it on the broadcast as well, that perhaps we're not even that. Because I'm delighted we won the game tonight and we won the game at Celtic Park, but I also watched us being completely outplayed by Leverkusen at Celtic Park. Despite the fact a lot of people thought we did a lot right that night, I'm sorry, if you get beat 4-0 at home, you've been outplayed, right? So where are we in terms of the European stage at this point in time, Lawrence?
I suppose we're building a new team, and you're not going to be the finished article, you know, in Angie's first foray into Europe. You know, I think it was 66, was it Liverpool beat us? You know, Bobby Lennox offside goal chopped off at Anfield.
Yep.
You know, the team's very much a work in progress, and, you know, there's potential there. Yeah, we could beat 4-0 with Leverkusen, but there was a couple of things, you know, that we'd done right. 4-3 away from home with Betis. You'd have probably taken a 4-3 before the game. Maybe not done it when you're a few goals ahead, you know, when you're 2-0 up very quickly. But listen, teams are a work in progress. And who's to say, you know, next season if we win the league that we can't do well in the Champions League? I mean, Gordon Strachan always says, you know, you get two last 16s with Caldwell and McManus as his centre-half pair. So I'm sure we could probably do the same with if it remains Starfelt and Carter Vickers. But listen, you know, would we beat Bayer 5-0 away to overtake the head-to-head with them to climb it? Or will we beat Betis? I don't know. But you know, listen, if it's third tier this year and build a bit of experience for next year's tilt, the group stages of the Champions League, why not?
I just think in terms of the circumstances in which Ange entered the building, Russell, any kind of European football beyond Christmas probably was unthinkable. I mean, we were entering the qualification stages of the Champions League with one right back at the club. One right back. And that's why Tony Ralston played. I mean, we can't revise history. That's why he played. But he grasps the opportunity. He deserves the contract extension that he's got. But we had one right back. We went into the second leg with Stephen Welsh and Dane Murray playing at centre-half. In the first game, Barkas was in goals. Somehow he's managed to craft the team to get us to the stage where we're looking beyond Christmas and we're saying, well, if we're still in Europe beyond Christmas. And I don't think it's lowering the expectations as such. I think it's taking stock of where we were when Ange Postecoglou came in, and we're trying to find as many positives as possible. Yeah, Livingston was a tough day at the office, but it wasn't a disaster. You know, there's going to be days like that regardless of who your manager is. And I just think that if we go through this year and we're still in Europe beyond Christmas, in many ways it will feel almost like a bonus because we are in a transition under Ange.
Well, I felt we were more being complimentary about the performance tonight, as opposed to, you know, I don't remember getting the pom-poms out that we're going to be in the Conference League, guaranteed at least. It was more about the performance tonight. It was very encouraging. Mm. So that would be what I would say to Terence. I firmly am on board that I feel expectation is getting dropped at times. But I believe also this season was a minefield, what was happening with the European campaign starting so early. Ange being appointed so late, the lack of options. Could some things have been done better? Potentially. Maybe there could have been. Maybe that's hindsight, though, you know. At the end of the day, he was picking up a squad that had, you know, let itself down last season, that were letting players go. Although I do think we still had, you know, a couple of the players that we sold are still available against Mitchell Ange. You know, I think it was still, I still think we should have got through that, if I'm honest. But whether we were to qualify for the group stage, completely different argument. In the Europa League, for me, we've won home and away against the nearest competition to us. Mm-hmm. But I also never want to, I think this is what Terence means, I never want to get to a stage where I'm celebrating coming third to Real Betis and Leverkusen. That's, you know, the bare minimum. And you want to be competing with these guys. You want to not be getting humped 4-0 at home to Leverkusen, because it puts shivers up your spine what they might do to us in Germany, you know? The Betis game at home, I hope it's still relevant when we play them. You know, imagine the scenes if we play them at home. That could be a brilliant game, you know? Mm-hmm. If we're playing them at home, winner takes all for the next phase of the Europa League as opposed to the Conference League. And fans have to be careful what they wish for, because a lot of the time when we were in the Champions League getting humped, there was a lot of stuff like, oh, you know, we're really a Europa League team. I'd rather we dropped in Europa League, finished third anyway, because we've got a better chance at it. You might start hearing that narrative again, you know, over the next few weeks, that maybe it'd be better if we dropped in the Conference League and make a fist of that. And I think that's what Terence is alluding to, that subconsciously you're dropping your standards. But on the basis of tonight, what I feel we're celebrating was a really accomplished away performance that showed good measure with the likes of Near Beaton, Stephen Welsh's, and we're raving about the goals we scored and how well crafted they were. All this done away from home with zero away fans in the stadium. That's what we're celebrating. I don't think anyone is going to be saying we want to be in the Conference League after Christmas. What we're saying is it's great to have that security with two games remaining. Now, let's make a push and get in the Europa League. And if that means, like Lauren says, having to get something in against Leverkusen away, do it. Go, have a go now, because to me, the reins are off. You know, we can have a go now in these next two games because we've got that safety net. But is it what we're aspiring to? No. Conference League is not what Celtic's aspiring to, I don't think.
Well, earlier on today, we had a great surprise in that two boxes arrived at the studio from Pie Sports, not Sky Sports, Pie Sports. They gave us loads of pies and bovril so we could watch the game. How good is that? Absolutely brilliant. And maybe it was your intention for us to show the logo on the screen, and I'm happy to do that because your macaroni pies were really good. So thanks very much. And anybody else that wants to send us any freebies, feel free. Feel free.
Listen, it's a former Celtic official pie eater. I think it really should give a professional opinion on the steak pies. The short crust pastry was outstanding. Lot of meaty filling in them. Really rich, great pie. It really held together well. You know, back in the day, I think people used to throw pies at certain players, and I think that would have worked.
A great pie. It'd been far
too good a pie to throw.
So the throwability factor adds to the quality of the pie then, Lawrence?
Well, it did in 1980s football, but I think that's far too good a pie to throw away. I mean, that is an outstanding pie. And, you know, whichever Celtic directors are watching tonight, it's perhaps a company should be contacted to get the pies in and try them.
Well, the worst pie I've ever had at the football was at Tynecastle, and I'll never forget the game because it was the game where they beat us 3-1, Russell, and Celtic fans started singing Always Look on the Bright Side, right? Tommy Coyne scored for Celtic to make it 1-1, I think it was, and it was 1-1 at half-time, and my old man went and got us two pies, and I'm not joking, you got a free drink because of the grease that came out of these pies was unbelievable. I can still taste it to this day. So Pie Sports was much better than the Tynecastle pies of the early 90s, that's for sure.
Mate, I would say they surpassed the Killie pies, those steak pies.
Wow. And by the way, Lawrence was an official pie eater. I mean, that is true.
Celtic's official pie
eater. Celtic's official pie
eater. Really?
Yeah, he was. He's got the T-shirt to prove it as well. And what he says to me is that he built himself up almost like it was a training regime where he could eat six full-size pies in one sitting. And he tried to do it tonight, and he only got to four, and he struggled to eat the fourth. But he did eat four full-size pies during that game.
And there's so much meat in it, mate. So much protein in those steak pies. I think that's maybe why they're so filling.
You know, sometimes on a Thursday, JP and I get stick for talking about music too long. And I think we've probably spoken about pies long enough as well. But it was an absolute pleasure for Russell and Lawrence to join us on A Celtic State of Mind. Thanks, everybody, for getting involved. We're well over 1,600 live. And if you haven't done so already, get subscribing on the channel. We're always giving away freebies. You might even get a free pie. There's a few more in the fridge. If you want them, I'll send them out. Thanks, everybody, for getting involved with A Celtic State of Mind.